Good afternoon and welcome to our media briefing. As the weather heats up, we've been working to loosen restrictions very soon in order to allow people to enjoy our coastline even more than they've been able to do up to this point. In recent weeks, we permitted people to swim, surf, kayak, and basically enjoy the waters at our beaches. But we know people have been anxious to sit and relax and sunbathe on the sand so that they can truly enjoy their day at the beach. Well, next week on Tuesday, June 2nd, passive activities will be allowed on beaches so long as groups stay within their household units, social distance from other non-family members, and wear facial coverings. We know our beaches define San Diego, and we've been meeting with coastal cities to figure out how passive activities can be done safely. We're taking this action as we continue to carefully allow some semblance of normality to resume in San Diego. San Diegans have been great about following the public health order, and because of that, we can further loosen restrictions like this. Let me thank the elected officials, law enforcement officials, and lifeguards from the coastal cities who have worked with us on rules for the beaches. Again, we're not allowing this change immediately. This will start on Tuesday, June 2nd, in order to give coastal cities time to prepare for a full reopening of the beaches. But next week, San Diegans will be able to enjoy our beaches even longer. Our endless summer has truly begun. Now let's switch gears and move to another topic. Over the years, I've donated more than 16 gallons of blood as a regular donor. I have also worked with our county employees in the San Diego Blood Bank to stage an annual county blood and bone marrow drive that is one of the largest drives in the region. I'm happy to note that today we have with us David Wellis, who is the CEO of the San Diego Blood Bank, on hand to talk about a new partnership on a convalescent therapeutic treatment to help those suffering from COVID-19. While we all know at this point there is no vaccine or treatment for COVID-19, plasma donated by those who have recovered from the illness may help patients fighting COVID-19. This is because the bodies of these recovered individuals have developed antibodies against the virus. Historically, this blood, called convalescent plasma, has been successfully used to treat similar diseases such as the 1918 flu epidemic and H1N1. Each plasma donation may be able to help as many as 3 or 4 people, so this effort will be critical to our campaign of fighting COVID-19. This new therapeutic treatment with convalescent plasma donation is part of our county's T3 strategy to test, trace, and treat, and we're excited to work with the blood bank on this campaign. I want to also add that I know right now, because there haven't been any blood drives over the last couple of months, there's a critical need for blood donors. So if you are a regular donor or would like to donate blood, you can either call the San Diego Blood Bank or the American Red Cross and arrange to do that. They critically need your blood because people now are getting elective surgeries and the supply has been way down over the last couple of months. So we ask you to consider that. But before we hear from the blood bank, let me call up Supervisor Nathan Fletcher.
Thank you and good afternoon. During the last number of months, we've asked San Diegans to make tremendous sacrifice in an effort to protect life. We've asked people to stay at home, wear face coverings, wash their hands, maintain physical distancing. And as we begin the recovery process, we are continuing to ask for the public's help in our response. As Supervisor Cox mentioned today, our focus is on asking folks to give of themselves in terms of their blood. Any time we have a natural disaster, a crisis, a public health emergency, where a large segment of our community is impacted, the usual blood donations and efforts at times can dwindle. They come in at a lower rate at a time where there may be a greater need. That is certainly true today. At the outset of our coronavirus pandemic, we saw a huge uptick in folks donating blood. There was a call to action. At that point, they were averaging about a 10-day supply of available blood. That is now down to a 2-day supply of available blood. And so we are asking San Diegans to continue to give of yourself a little bit more. The sacrifices we made in staying home are sacrifices that saved lives, a lot of lives, right here in San Diego County. Now we're asking you to just donate a little bit of your blood. Again, a simple step and action you can take that also has the potential to save lives and help one another's. I know for years of my life as a Marine, and in particular in combat, we literally wore our blood type on our sleeve and written on our boot. I know how vitally important a available supply of blood is to our region, and so we are asking all San Diegans to reach out to the San Diego Blood Bank or the Red Cross and arrange a donation if you are able. It is something we can all do to help as we go through this. And then to reiterate the point that was made, there is, you know, while we've often talked about the need for a vaccine or a therapeutic treatment, there are folks working incredibly hard on both of those, including around-the-clock effort and work around a therapeutic treatment, and particularly the possibility that was just talked about around using the plasma of individuals who have tested positive, taking their blood. I know Dr. McDonald, Dr. Infantides, Dr. Berg have been working with the San Diego Blood Bank on this innovative project that essentially can take the blood from anyone who has tested positive and recovered and utilize the antibodies created within their system to provide a form of therapeutic treatment and a form of help and assistance. The convalescent plasma donation is a way that, again, we can help one another. This program is limited to those who have previously tested positive. We are over 7,000 positive cases in our region that we know of. We are doing our very best to reach out to those 7,000 individuals. This is voluntary if they choose to participate, but it is something that we are raising attention about, raising awareness about, and if you're an individual out there who has received a positive test, we would encourage you to reach out to the San Diego Blood Bank, share with them your status, and see if you are a likely candidate in order to participate in this convalescent plasma project. We think that it has the potential to help our region and help us as we recover. So, two ways, every San Diegan can participate. If you haven't tested positive for COVID, we would like you to give blood. We need it on hand, and it helps our entire medical system and our entire county. If you have tested positive, we would like you to consider being a candidate to donate plasma, because again, we think that this has the potential and promise to help us. San Diego Blood Bank is a trusted partner. We are pleased to partner with them and work closely with them, and we appreciate all of their efforts and what they're doing, and you'll hear from their CEO in just a second. Before we bring him up, let's do a quick run-through of our daily metrics and charts, beginning with our testing, 3,699. Again, a little bit of a lag from some of the state sites reporting in, the state drive-up testing, along with the continued lag coming out of an extended holiday weekend. But we're now over 147,000 tests reported to us in the region, and our seven-day average is there about 3,800. Contact tracers in our tracing program, we're at 383 on hand and available, over 8,500 investigations performed. And then in our treatment, you see our public health motel rooms and the cumulative. Today we are reporting 117 new positive cases. This is out of 3,699 total tests reported, which gets us at 3%. Our rolling 14-day average is 3.1%, and so we are holding steady in that regard. Daily hospital census up a little bit, 156 in ICU, 408 total. Again, these are COVID-related hospitalizations. The orange number there is those who are in ICU. The blue number is ICU plus non-ICU in our area's hospital systems. And then on the next chart, you can see where that 3,951 is relative to the 80% bed capacity that we are keeping an eye on a daily basis. The last one I have for you today is just our ICU utilization. Again, we shared this earlier, we're at 465 total in ICUs. Out of the 702 ICU beds available in our county, our ICU capacity would be 66% occupied as of today. Next, I want to introduce to share more with you about the plasma donation program, the collaboration between the county and the San Diego Blood Bank. I'm pleased to introduce Dr. David Welles, the CEO of the San Diego Blood Bank.
Thank you, Councilman Fletcher. Pleasure to be here. As a proud and longtime partner with San Diego County and Live Well San Diego, we couldn't be more excited, actually, to have even greater impact in our community's health by collaborating with the county on their T3 strategy of testing, tracing, and treating COVID-19. As there are no approved treatments for COVID-19, the FDA has allowed emergency use of COVID convalescent plasma, or CCP, is what we call it in the industry, to treat the disease. Convalescent plasma, as Chairman Cox had mentioned, has been used historically for a number of different diseases, so SARS, MERS, H1N1, and it has been shown to be beneficial. Early anecdotal data for COVID-19 looks promising as well. So how does it work? Your immune system creates antibodies to a particular disease, and those antibodies stay in your blood after you recover. The plasma donated by recovered COVID patients contain those antibodies and can help others who are currently sick with COVID-19. So who can donate CCP? All individuals who have been tested positive, confirmed positive, and there are over 7,000 here with the county, and have been symptom-free for at least 28 days, can come to us and donate plasma. The current hospital demand for CCP is great. As of this morning, San Diego Blood Bank has shipped 377 doses of CCP across the Southern California and particularly San Diego region. But we're not meeting the demand, and that sets the stage for this very innovative partnership. So all individuals who are confirmed to have COVID-19 are reported to the county, creating a potential CCP donor pool that can be leverage to help our community. So our collaboration is basically a two-pronged approach. The county will educate those who are recently tested positive about the importance of donating plasma after you've recovered, and they can also recontact those that have been diagnosed positive but have already recovered to come and consider donating CCP to San Diego Blood Bank. San Diego Blood Bank will then, of course, collect and distribute that CCP to local hospitals. So it's actually quite simple, but tremendously impactful as a partnership. So I'd like to thank everyone at the county for what they've done in keeping our San Diego community safe and well, and look forward to having additional impact as we work together through COVID-19. And finally, don't forget to donate blood either way, if you're healthy and or COVID recovered and healthy. Supplies have actually dropped as hospitals are ramping back up. So thank you. So next, I'd like to call up Dr. Wilma Wooten, our Director of Public Health.
Thank you, David. As CEO of the San Diego Blood Bank, we are very thankful for this partnership that you've described, and it helps us to achieve one of the indicators at the federal level for therapeutics. So we are very excited about this partnership. And I would like to thank everyone for being here this afternoon. The COVID-19 update of global, national, and state statistics are based on data from the Johns Hopkins dashboard. And today, this information was obtained at about noon. So globally, there are almost 6 million positive cases, including almost 359,000 deaths. Nationwide, the United States is reporting over 1.7 million positive cases, still 29% of the total global number, and includes over 101,000 deaths. Statewide, California is reporting almost 102,000 positive cases, which includes 3,918 deaths. Today, the County of San Diego is reporting 7,100 cases, which is 117 more cases than we reported yesterday, and includes 260 deaths, which is 5 more deaths than reported yesterday. The age range has unchanged from 3 months to 101 years of age. We have 52% of the total number of cases between the ages of 20 and 49 years of age, and that is a total of 3,711 cases. Age, or rather gender, remains unchanged, with 50% female and approximately 50% being male. For those that have been hospitalized, we have 1,285, or 18% of the total cases. And of the number of individuals hospitalized, 377, or 5% of the total, have been admitted to the intensive care unit, which also represents 30% of the total number of those hospitalized. For the total number of deaths, 260, this represents 4% of the total number of cases. Of the 5 additional deaths reported today, the dates of these deaths occurred between May 14th and May 25th. The age range is from 64 to 97 years of age, and all new deaths had underlying medical conditions. Also, of the total 260 deaths, 43% were female and 57% were male. 251 had underlying medical conditions, which represents 97% of the total number of deaths. 8 had no underlying medical conditions, or 3% of the total deaths. Regarding race and ethnicity of all deaths, we have data for 93%, or 243 of the 260. And this means we do not have race and ethnicity data for 17 of the total. Of the total number for which we do have race and ethnicity data, 110, or 45%, are white, 102, or 42%, are Hispanic or Latino, 20, or 8%, are Asian, 7, or 3%, are Black or African American, 2, or 0.8%, are Pacific Islanders, 1, or 0.4%, is American Indian, and 1, or 0.4%, is of multiple races. Once again, our sincerest sympathies and condolences go out to the families and friends of those reported today who lost their lives to COVID-19. All of the information that I've shared with you and more can be found on our county's website. In regard to reported outbreaks in congregate and community settings, today there is a cumulative total of 79 confirmed active outbreaks, with 3 congregate and 1 community outbreaks now being documented as closed or inactive. And this means that there have been no new cases in these 3 facilities over the past 14 days. Of the 79 active outbreaks, 55 are in congregate facilities. There are 2 new outbreaks in this category since yesterday, with a total number of congregate cases at 1,550, which represents 22% of the total COVID-19 positive cases, and includes 127 deaths. And we have 24 active outbreaks in community setting locations, 1 new outbreak since yesterday, and includes 328 cases and 5 deaths. So our goal of testing approximately 5,000 individuals per day is well within sight, and we are trending in the right direction with our metrics. The weeks ahead are going to be very critical in maintaining our progress to slow the spread of COVID-19. As we have reopened businesses and activities, we must continue to be vigilant with practicing hand hygiene, sanitation, face coverings, as well as social distancing and screenings where appropriate. Remember that practicing these strategies is going to be very important to maintaining and continuing to reopen our businesses. Research has shown that when face coverings are used properly, they reduce transmission of COVID-19 or other respiratory illnesses. According to the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention, face coverings disrupt the trajectory of a cough, sneeze, or even droplets that are dispelled through breathing, thereby preventing droplets carrying the virus from traveling between individuals. Since individuals can be contagious before they have symptoms or not have symptoms at all, we can't know with certainty who is contagious. So the best protection when you or outside of your household is for everyone 2 years of age and older to cover your mouth and nose with a face covering. People who choose not to wear face coverings may be denied access to businesses, transit, or recreational areas. Time is of the essence and every act counts. So please practice physical distancing and healthy hygiene. When you leave your place, cover your face. And each and every one of us has the power to make a difference, and we want you to make that difference. Now please welcome back to the podium, Chairman Cox. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Wooten. We'll go directly to the questions.
John Carroll with KPBS, please state your question.
Hi, this kind of dovetails off of what Dr. Wooten was just saying, so whoever you feel is appropriate to answer is fine with me. I've been noticing myself, and I've talked to a lot of friends and family, that over the last week or two, a lot more people are out in public with no facial coverings on. And I'm just wondering, I know that Dr. Wooten just made the point about how important it is, but what do you think when you see that out in the community? What do you want to tell those people?
I'm going to let Supervisor Fletcher respond to that.
Thank you, John. That's been a growing concern, is in some ways have we become a victim of our own success, and that we had so much incredible success so early. We moved early as a community, one of the first counties to move to try and address this. We had widespread community support. And so at times there can be a disconnect between the actions that we've taken and the outcomes that we've seen. The reason that we have had such incredible success is because of the things that we did. And as we begin to change those things and loosen things up, we've really tried to drive home the point that in order to limit the spread, because coronavirus remains out there, there is no vaccine, there is no widespread available treatment. And so in order to contain the spread as we begin to loosen, we are really at times requiring via public health order, but also asking the public for genuine commitment to allow us to continue to move forward and to not throw away the sacrifice that's been made by adhering to the things. It is a temporary thing. I don't think any of us envision, you know, that once we have a vaccine and we're there, that these things will continue. But we are asking the public to continue to be vigilant and continue to take that same level of commitment we made a month or 2 months ago and apply it to an adapted way in this new mindset, and that is face coverings. That is physical distancing for non-household units. That is hand washing. That is temperature checks and screenings. And if we can get widespread adherence to those things and we have the testing, the tracing, and the treatment going, that gives us our best hope of a smooth and even recovery. And continue to reiterate to the public, that's not only in our public health interest in terms of saving lives and protecting our healthcare system capacity, that is in our economic interest. The worst thing economically that could happen would be a second wave that would force us to dial things back, and none of us want to do that. And so we realize there's a lot of misinformation out there around the utility and value of face coverings. There's a lot of misinformation out there around the potential dangers surrounding coronavirus. And so we continue to ask the public to be partners, because these are steps that are taken that are designed to allow us to reopen and get as much of our life back as possible as we go through this. So again, our message is very simple. Just, we are trying to ask the public to continue to help us because it will. These are things that have been put in place not in an effort to inconvenience anyone or restrict anyone's liberty or freedom. These are things that are put in place to protect life and protect our recovery.
Thank you, Supervisor.
Okay, let's go to the next question.
Joshua Smith with the San Diego Union Tribune. Please state your question.
Hey, I have a couple of questions. The first one is that I believe I read that San Diego County has had roughly 80 outbreaks, about 70 of which have occurred in congregate and community settings. To what do county public health officials attribute that?
Dr. Wooten will respond.
Good afternoon, Joshua. Actually, what I just reported, and thank you for that question, In submitting our attestation form to the state, vulnerable populations is a cornerstone of the application, and that includes individuals that are in congregate care facilities, correctional system, and our homeless. And so with the long-term care facilities, today I reported that we have a total of 79 confirmed active outbreaks, and we have deemed three congregate and one community outbreak setting as inactive, and that means there have not been any activity in the past 14 days. And we anticipate that we will see more of these inactivations occurring over the coming weeks. What do we attribute that to is certainly the residents that are in the facilities aren't going out into the community. So that's why we also very early on stopped visitations or allowed for the administrative leadership to determine visitation at the facilities. But infection is being brought in by the staff that work in the facility because, as I've stated, the residents, they are there and not going and coming unless it's a facility where individuals are ambulatory. But for the lion's share, particularly in our SNFs, the residents, they're not bringing it in. So that's why it's very important for infection prevention and control measures to be in place. And we've tried to develop a process. When we have an outbreak, we have a strike team that goes out to conduct that assessment. And since last month, we've offered testing for our long-term care facilities, starting out with the facilities that have outbreaks. So the simple answer is it is being brought in from outside, and that's why it's very important hand hygiene and sanitation is implemented in facilities where you have people staying so that there is not the increased spread or production of or transmission of COVID-19. And you had a couple of other questions?
Just one more question. To what extent are you and other public health officials concerned about the airborne spread of the coronavirus via aerosols, especially in indoor settings such as restaurants and casinos?
Well, as is well known, we take our direction from the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention, and CDC has determined that COVID-19 infections are transmitted via droplet transmission. If there are procedures performed that produces aerosols, then there is aerosolization. But in general, this is transmitted through droplet transmission. That's the science and evidence that we have today. And I understand your question about studies that are going on, but we are going with the current evidence. And as new evidence comes available, we will take the necessary actions. But right now, we are operating on guidance from CDC to that.
Okay.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Okay, we have one last call-in question.
Hunter Sowards, KUSI, please state your question.
Hi, thank you. I am wanting to get a little more information on passive activity that's going to be allowed next week, just what enforcement will look like, and if this includes the boardwalks. And then my second question would be if we are moving further into the next stages of stage three, have we gotten an update from the governor on the proposed pilot program?
Okay, at this point, we have not gotten any direct response back on the pilot program, although elements of what we submitted as a pilot program, I think, were approved by the governor just the last couple of days. So that answers that question. And for the first part of the question, I'll call up Supervisor Fletcher.
Thank you. The decision of whether open boardwalks is a decision of each individual jurisdiction. Who has a boardwalk. If they choose to open them, they certainly are allowed to do that now. And the enforcement would be the same as it has been previously as it relates to beach activities. This will be that jurisdiction's law enforcement and lifeguards working together to properly enforce the guidance. So no change in who will do the enforcement. just a modest change, and again, not coming until next week, around what local jurisdictions may allow on their beaches.
And what are you asking, kind of like I said, as you said, that they're wanting them to have time to prepare, will it be just making sure people are social distancing and not in big groups? What are you anticipating being the struggle as we move into this next step?
Well, you'd have to, in some ways, talk to each jurisdiction about what their individual challenges may be as they see moving forward. I think, in general, we've worked with the coastal mayors, city managers, lifeguards, law enforcement, and they think this is a step, an appropriate step that we can take now that they feel comfortable that they will be able to enforce. But again, the decision to actually implement these changes will be at each of those jurisdictions who control the access to the beaches in terms of their ability. We're just lifting the countywide restriction and allowing them to move forward. But in working with them, they don't have and expressed any concerns about the inability to enforce. Obviously, what we want to avoid are the types of scenes and situations that we've seen from around the country and from some other counties in California, which is significant overcrowding. And so allowing household units and having only household units stay together, hopefully that ensures that there are small groups that are in proximity and that all of those groups are physically distanced from each other.
Thank you so much.
Apparently we have one more caller.
Taryn Mento with KPBS, please state your question.
Yeah, hi, Taryn Mento, KPBS. Sorry I called late. Thanks for taking the question. My question is about data. You have all made a lot of data readily available very quickly, but now as we're getting to later stages, I want to know about data that's related to the triggers that you've identified, things like the PPE supplies at hospitals. Are you going to be, and also outbreaks at community facilities? I know some other counties make these readily available, but this is something that we have to wait for each press conference to get that information from Dr. Wooten. Are you going to be making that data readily available as we are more focused on the triggers?
Dr. Wooten's going to respond.
Thank you. That really is a great question and much appreciated. We actually are going through the triggers that were submitted in the attestation application last week, and our goal is to have just to have the database on the coronavirus-sd.com website. So we will have that. We will be presenting the triggers to our Board of Supervisors next Tuesday and anticipate having those data online after that board meeting.
And would it be updated daily the same way that the case count and hospitalizations
yes.
are?
Yes, ma'am. It will be updated daily. Mm-hmm.
Thank you.
Oh, we have text questions. The first one is from Pam Cragen with the San Diego UT. Are there any other categories of businesses still remaining to be opened in phase two? And if not, do you have a projected date for the launch of phase three?
So for phase two, unless the governor comes out, and as you are aware, the two businesses that were launched just a couple of days ago were originally in phase three, but the governor moved them to phase two in the accelerated portion of stage two. So I'm not aware of any other businesses or industries that will be moved to stage two. And as we have all heard, the governor's plan is that the entire state will transition to stage three. So as far as I know, that is the plan as of today. If you have further questions, I would encourage you to inquire at the state.
And this question is from Abby Alford with CBS 8. When will weddings outside of church weddings be allowed? Will there be a certain number of people? What guidelines for wedding party and wedding event venues will there be?
Well, when the state convened local health officers earlier, actually over the weekend and on Sunday, it was very clear that weddings were not included in church services. So that is anticipated to be a part of stage three. So as far as we know, weddings in general, because weddings usually entail people coming from out of town, from other counties, other states, and even sometimes other countries. So that's why weddings were not included in the church services guidance that we recently received.
And the second part of her question, what is the update for LPRES reopening? Have they presented a safe reopening plan, and where is it in the process of the county as far as allowing them to reopen?
Thank you for that question. Yeah, we met earlier this week with the owner of the restaurant, and today there is actually a Department of Environmental Health inspection going on. So once that report is completed, if everything checks out there, we are happy to rescind the order that was issued last week for them to close.
All right, thank you, Dr. Wooten.
This next question deals with summer camps for organizations like YMCAs and Boys and Girls Clubs, and Supervisor Fletcher is going to respond.
And this is from Andrea with the San Diego Union Tribune. Organizations like the YMCA and the Boys and Girls Club have announced that they will hold summer camps as early as June. Is the county providing any safety guidance to these organizations, and are they required to submit reopening plans for review from the county?
All of the child care facilities or summer camps would fall under the guidance that's been issued around child care. So we've put out guidance in terms of the numbers, how they should operate, hygiene standards, and other types of things. And so the expectation is that they will comply with each of those orders, with the summer camp serving as a form of child care. So that is, we've put out that guidance, and we certainly expect and anticipate they will fully comply with that.
Thank you, Supervisor Fletcher.
This next question deals with a new program that was just announced yesterday in regards to testing, and Nick Mascione is going to respond.
Yes, this question is from Will Huntsbury from the Voice of San Diego. The UT reported that Rady will be able to test 2,000 children per day. Do they have the testing capacity now, and will all of those tests be done internally by Rady?
The new launched collaborative COVID collaborative for children, which is being led by Rady's and other hospitals that are joining as well, is currently focusing on the Rady's network of their physician offices, their outpatient, their urgent care, their hospital. Presently today, Rady's lab can handle 2,000 tests daily. They're averaging at about 200 tests currently. They're ramping up over the next week and achieving about 2,000 tests in about 2 to 3 weeks.
Thank you, Nick.
This next question is also about testing. It's regarding the goal of 5,200 tests per day, and Dr. Wooten's going to respond.
Okay. This one is from, let me find it again. My apologies. This is a beach one. Let me get to this one first, and then we'll find the testing one. This is from Kelly from Fox 5. Does your announcement about being able to sit on the beach apply countywide, or do the jurisdictions each make their own rules?
So I think that, as has been stated earlier, all of the beach cities got together and agreed. We shared with them what the what could be done, and their decision was when they wanted to reopen. So we are anticipating that this will be consistent across the entire county.
Okay, great. And this next one is from Cody Delaney from iNews Source. What are the roadblocks or challenges in achieving the county's goal of testing 5,200 people per day?
Well, the usual challenges are all of the elements. I think that has been described here previously. Before you get to the point of testing, you have to look at, do you all have all of the elements, the supplies, the things that are needed to collect the specimens. And then once you collect the specimens, then they are tested. We clearly have the capacity. That was one of the requirements for the attestation. application that was submitted to the state. The first goal the state required is 1.5 tests per 1,000 population. So that's just 50 shy of 5,000. We have set an overall goal of 5,160 tests, rounding up to 5,200. When we go to stage three, the state requirement should or could be two tests per 1,000 population. So that's about 6,600. So we are, with all of the various partnerships, you've heard about our partnership with Rady. There are others that we're looking at. And also, when you look at our prioritization from the federal government, from the state, and then from our county prioritizations, there are four levels. Basically, anyone who wants a test can get it. So how does one obtain a test? If you have your health, if you have a healthcare provider, we want you to call them first. If you cannot obtain a test through your healthcare provider, call 211, and then you can arrange to either have it done through our county drive-in or drive-up. We also have the state but walk-up. So there are multiple opportunities there. And also we have testing for those vulnerable populations. We have arrangements for our first responders, for the vulnerable populations, which includes our homeless individuals, as well as our long-term care facility and our correctional system. So we've tried to cover all of the different categories of vulnerable populations, and include all of those categories as specified at the in the federal government's guidance, as well as the state. And then again, we created our own. So if all is lost, call 211, and they should be able to help you find out where you can obtain a test if you do not have a healthcare provider.
Thank you, Dr. Luton.
That concludes our questions for today. And I don't want to be repetitive, but I really want to emphasize that yesterday we had, a very historic event. Supervisor Fletcher and I were joined with our county public health officials at Rady's Children's Hospital to announce that new campaign to test children and their families. The COVID-19 Collaborative for Children effort will be able to test up to 2,000 children per day, as was mentioned, but it also includes families and caregivers, and that's on a daily basis, up to 2,000 tests. Because Rady will offer free voluntary testing at all satellite facilities throughout the region, this effort will help give us a broader picture of the spread of the virus in the community and boost our testing overall. Rady's Children's Hospital has been a great partner over the year and have watched out for children in this region and their families for over 65 years now. I want to thank them for participating and partnering with the county on this very important effort. Speaking of testing, we have more good news to announce. We know South County has been hit particularly hard by the coronavirus, and the number of cases there is certainly the largest in the region. We've been working diligently to address the situation there and provide more services. To that end, I'm happy to announce that starting tomorrow, we will add a drive-up testing site at the Aquatica Water Park in Chula Vista. This site will be open Monday through Friday from 9 a.m. to 3 p.m. and will be able to take up to 180 appointments a day. No, the big wave pool will not be available. The water slides won't be open, but this is a great way to use a closed facility to help address our public health needs. And I want to thank SeaWorld and Aquatica for working with the county on this effort. The Aquatica testing has already joined our other efforts in South County, including a drive-up testing location that's been combined with a food distribution event organized by Mayor Alejandra Sotelo Solis in National City. And testing sites in Imperial Beach and San Ysidro are also operational. And we are opening two other sites tomorrow. One is at the Oceanside Livewell Center, which is located at 1701 Mission Avenue in Oceanside. It will be available for up to 90 tests per day and will be open Monday through Friday, 10 a.m. to 2 p.m. And in central San Diego, we'll be doing testing at a parking lot at USD at 5998 Alcala Park. The site will be able to do up 180 tests per day, and this will be open on Monday through Friday from 9 a.m. to 3 p.m. We do testing throughout the entire region, and I encourage you to sign up to get tested. You can call the state line, and the number is 888-634-1123. That's 888-634-1123. Or you can contact the County Public Health Nurse Line by calling 211, then selecting your language and pressing 1. Just a reminder that we will not be holding a briefing tomorrow, but we will be back on Monday. Our County Communications Office will send out daily updates over the weekend. And again, you can log on to our coronavirus website for daily updates. And that website is coronavirus-sd.com. Well, that's it for today. Until Monday again, please stay safe and make sure you wear your facial coverings. Thank you.